promise you, girls and demons, this is Nurse Hatchet. You are listening to the Wolf Pack.
The genre of horror is a great expanse.
Great expanse.
We want to explore it. We've spent years building our credibility, our reputation, interviewing people from all levels of horror, discussing visual and literary horror. This is our exploration. This is
Full Spectrum Horror.
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more.
Oh, You know there's going to be sex, drugs, rock and roll, ships, dips, chains, whips. You know, your basic high school orgy type of thing. I mean, I'm not talking candle wax on the nipples or witchcraft or anything like that. No, no, no. Just a couple of hundred kids running around in their underwear acting like complete animals. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another Full Spectrum Horror episode. I am your host for the evening, Martha Mucky Desaad. And there's another person that that does this show. He's chained up in a dungeon somewhere, getting his butt spanked. What is his name again? Oh yes, Eric Morse. Is it? Are you there?
I don't think so, Mr. Highland. Gordon scares everybody. This is William Pattison, a.k.a. Eric Morris. And I got a little something to say to you, Mr. Highland.
What?
Yeah. This is in regard to you getting forcing me to watch this film. And this comes from Mr. Samuel L. Jackson.
Oh?
Yeah. The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the iniquities of selfish and the tyranny of evil men. Blessed is he who, in the name of charity and goodwill, shepherds the weak through the darkness. For he is truly his brother's keeper and the finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know I am the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon you. There you go, Mr. Island. And just remember that. Vengeance is gonna be sweet, Mr. Island.
Save it for later.
Something. I am going to have to find something. You know, I mean. Oh, wait a second. You know, you still gotta spend a night in the haunted demon baby house.
The heck are you talking about?
The haunted demon baby house in Chicago.
I have no idea about that. What
oh, yes.
That? Where is that?
Oh, we'll find out so that you can spend the night there. All by yourself.
I've never heard of it.
With the demon baby with its horns and hooves running around going, at you. Alrighty, so anyways, yes, people, Mr. Highland literally tortured me with this damn movie.
Should we tell them what happened last week?
I guess so, because, yeah, doubly tortured, people. I am getting absolutely doubly tortured, and I am pissed at Uber Conference because of this, because they remodeled their site, and now to record a conference call, which is how we do our podcast, you have to go to an entirely different page to find the damn record button. So here I'm thinking, oh, there's no record button. I guess it goes on automatically because everybody records their conference calls anyways. But no. So I had to suffer through all this. Last week. And suffered horribly. And now I have to suffer again. Oh, God.
Yes, Marquita Highland. As I said, vengeance shall be upon you, and you will know that I am the Lord. All right. So anyways, yeah, so yeah, tortured and stuff, and it's fitting when it comes down to this piece of anyways. Let's go to our sponsors, and yes, our show is sponsored by Nos, Mr. Highland's favorite drink, Nos.
No.
Bang.
No. One, the first one gives you a heart attack, and the second one gives you, makes your head explode.
Yeah. Of course, Mr. Highland loves our third sponsor, though.
Wait, I have to get the script.
Huh?
I have to get the script.
Okay, so anyway.
I forgot to get it. It's coming. Hold on.
Our third host is Toastios.
Yes. And I finally was able to rewrite the script.
Oh boy. After your decision for this week's show, I am really overly excited not about what your commercial's gonna be like.
Yes, and this one's all about you.
Oh, and the thing is that this is the first commercial that Mr. Highlands wrote, so this is very special, and we'll be grading him for it.
Okay.
Put a little pressure on.
Let me see if I can get the voice that I was imagining myself doing. I see it all the time. Your friends invite you out, and you're always busy. Eventually, they invite someone else, like, say, Eric Morse. Do you really want Eric Morse in your shower, hiding in the bushes, taking pictures, finding him in the fridge, sleeping or his head in the freezer, bonding over chips and recipes, hiding bodies in the backyard? Suddenly, you will find Eric Morse at your sister's wedding, where you're supposed to be, or even be her bridesmaid in your place. And you look so good in fishnet stockings or even sock garters. And you just got morsed. Don't get morsed. All because of those damn chips called something or other.
Uh-huh. Okay, for one thing, I look horrible in fishnets. And for another thing, I don't hide in refrigerators because you freeze to death in them. Okay, so let me see. Let me give you a C+ on your commercial there, Mr. Highland. C+. And the plus is only because the voice was actually good.
Well, I was trying to imitate Raul Julia.
You're Raul Julia?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that knocks it down.
Oh.
God. What's wrong, kiddies? Is Mr. Highland not doing it right?
I forgot to say C+.
Yeah, C+. 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 Yeah, see me with the witch's hat. Little Ralphie. Yeah, you'll shoot your eye out. Alrighty, so anyways, it is time for that time that Mr. Highland really enjoys, which is horror news. Mr. Highland spends all month going around the internet looking for that weird, that strange, that horror news just for you.
Yes, and since a week passed, I managed to find another news item, and I will start with that. And I am pleasantly surprised at this. The novel cover by Jack Ketchum is now an Audible audiobook. And I must say, it's about time. Because I read this book a number of years ago, and it's one of his better ones. Next is...
Yeah, so you got to catch him, definitely.
Next is the vampire novel Nightblood by T. Chris Martindale. This will be reprinted by Valancourt Press on November 12th. Now, this is another novel that I've read in recent years. It's a lot of fun. It's one of the better ones. So definitely check that out. Next is the EC Archives Impact. They'll be released April 14th of next year. Next is The Spirit by Thomas Page. That's also out on Audible. Next is The Science of Women in Horror. That'll be released February 14th. And this next one, I don't have a date. Doctors Wear Scarlet by Simon Raven. That's another Valancourt one. And this next one, I'm rather pleasantly surprised. I didn't expect this, but the novel Wet Bones by John Shirley, that is now out on Audible. And this also, this next one is also a surprise. The novelization of The Omen will be released as an audiobook, Audible and audio CD, narrated by Holly Palance, who was also in the movie. And this will be released October 8th. Next, The Hanjin Murders by Seishi Yokomizo will be translated into English for the very first time. And that'll be released December 5th. And last, but certainly not the least, and this ties into tonight's subject matter, the novel Aline and Valcour by Marquis de Sade will be translated into English for the very first time. And that will be released December 2nd. And that concludes my news for this evening.
Alrighty, well, here comes my news, and several of these items is stuff that Mr. Highland will go nuts over because, you know, these are just stuff that he'll absolutely love and he'll want to buy. First off, Funko will be releasing a vampire, Mr. Burns from Simpsons Treehouse of Terror. Pop.
My God.
New York Comic-Con exclusive. Now, this pop will also likely be available with FYE as well. So, hopefully, Mr. Highland, you got an FYE near your place so that you can get yourself your vampire Mr. Burns. Because I know you love Mr. Burns.
I remember that segment from that Halloween episode.
Cool.
That's a really good one.
Yeah, and here's another one Mr. Highland is going to be just running out there to get because it's his favorite new vocalist from Ghost. Papa Emeritus II has received his own pop vinyl figure from Funko. It's available exclusively at Hot Topic for $12.50. Yep, I know you're going to be going after that there, Mr. Highland. I know that. Alrighty, next. Ash and the Evil Dead is sadly over, but the show lives on with merchandise from Fright Rags. Four new t-shirts designed by Jeffrey Blazeman and Kyle Crawford and Matthew Skiff are available for $28 each. I saw the pictures of these. They've got one that I particularly recommend. It's the Ashy Slashy hand puppet t-shirt. It is hilarious. It's great. The company has also created Ash versus the Evil Dead wax pack trading cards priced at $5 each pack, contains 10 trading cards and a sticker per season. I know Mr. Highland's going to be going over at, you know, and wanting those, you know, for his trading card collection. All righty. Well, one thing I got to say is, unfortunately, we do not have any Scream Factory releases for this month in horror. So I found through my sources a few items from Arrow Video. So I've got some, and some of these seem like stuff that Mr. Highland would be interested in, definitely. Hitchhike to Hell will be released on Blu-ray on November 19th via Arrow Video. Twins of Evil designed the new cover. The original poster is on the reverse side, inspired by the crimes of serial killer Edmund Kemper, also known as the co-ed killer. The 1977 film is Erwin Berzwick, the monster of Peter Ragus, Robert Gibbons, Russell Johnson, and John Hammond star. All right. Yeah, you're having computer. Okay, Hitchhike to Hell has been newly restored in 2K from original film elements and two aspect ratios, 1.33 and 1.78, with original uncompressed mono audio. Extras are below. Special features. Video appreciation by Nightmare USA author Stephen Thrower. Roads to Nowhere. Hitchhiking culture goes to hell. Cinema essay exploring the dark side of hitchhiking by Alexandria Heller Nicholas. Theatrical trailer. Original press book. That's a ROM that's added. Okay, here's a synopsis. Howard is a mild-mannered mama boy whose job running deliveries for a cleaning agency affords him a lot of time out on the road. It's not until he picks up young women who run away from home that he transforms into a twitching, homicidal maniac hell-bent on meting out punishment for their transgressions. Can the cops put a stop to Howard's demented spree before he claims yet another victim? Guess we're going to have to watch that one to find out. Alrighty, and here's another one I know Mr. Highland will be interested in. Apprentice to Murder will be released on Blu-ray on November 5th via Era Video. Haunt Love, new cover art. The original poster will be on the reverse side. Inspired by true events, the 1988 horror film is directed by Ralph L. Thomas, Ticket to Heaven, and co-written by Alan Scott, Don't Look Now, and has Donald Sutherland, Chad Lowe, and Mia Sara starring. Apprentice to Murder has been newly restored in 2K from the original 35 millimeter with original lossless soundtrack. Extras are... Okay, here we go. Audio commentary by author critic Brian Reisman. Interview with cinematographer Kelvin Pike. Interview with makeup supervisor Robin Grantham. Diabolique magazine editor-in-chief Kate Ellinger on religious horror cinema. Theatrical trailer. In early 20th century Pennsylvania, Dutch County, young Billy Kelly Chadlow falls in with a charismatic power and folk magic healer, Dr. John Reese, Donald Sutherland. Stunned by the rest of the community for, or shunned by the rest of the community for his non-conformist beliefs. Together, they investigate the mysterious sickness that is blighting the area, which Reese believes to be the work of a sinister local hermit. But as the plague spreads, the wide-eyed Billy falls ever deeper under Reese's spell. Are they doing God's work or the devil's bidding? All righty, now we come to the final film from Arrow release, and I know Mr. Highland is all excited about this. Oh, yes. RoboCop will be released on Blu-ray on November 26th via Arrow Video. It features new cover by Paul Shipper with original poster on the reverse side. A steel edition will be also available. I know, Mr. Highland, you're going to want the steel edition. You love those steel edition ones. Two-disc limited edition set includes both the theatrical and director's cuts, along with six postcards, a double-sided poster, a booklet featuring new writing on the film by Omar Ahmed and Christopher Griffiths and Henry Blythe, a 1987 Fangoria interview with effects artist Robert Botten, and publicity materials. The 1987 action classic is directed by Paul Verhoeven. Total Recall, Starship Troopers, and stars Peter Weller, Nancy Allen, Daniel O'Hareth, Ronnie Cox, Kurt Woodsmith, and Mogul Ferrer. RoboCop has been restored in 4K with original camera negative by MGM Transfer in 2013 and approved by Verhoeven himself. It features original lossless stereo and four channel mix, plus DTS HDMA 5.1 surround option on both cuts. Now, let me just put it this way. There are a shitload of features on this stuff, including they also have a television version of the movie on here, but they've got like 10 different documentaries on here, a half dozen interviews with people from the production. I'm just doing it this way because Mr. Highland fell asleep the last time I did this, and it's so damn long. But this is a monster of a release. Let me just put it that way. It is a monster. It is huge. You got, the last time I saw something like this was the complete, Matrix series that they had out on DVD. I mean, this thing is huge just for one movie. So anyways, yeah, so that is the horror news for this time. So, Mr. Island, you want to do the fan mail before we go on to music break?
What about our reviews?
Oh, yeah, our reviews. Okay, I keep forgetting. Didn't we do that last time that I forgot the reviews again? Oh, my God, it's happening again. Okay. Yeah, it's movies. Mr. Highland spent the entire month looking for those movies just for you to review.
Yes, and thankfully I don't have many, and I only have one. And what it consists of isn't much, because I couldn't find much. So, this is a movie that I've never heard of until recent weeks. It is called Spirit of Evil. It is a Russian film, also called VIY. This is from 1967. This is based on a Nikolai Gogol story. Seems to have two directors, Konstantin Gershov and, probably going to mispronounce the other name, Georgi Kropotkin. Anyway, it's about this man who's part of a seminary. He's wandering around and at night, and he comes across this old lady who happens to be a witch, and they go flying around. And she ends up getting killed, but not before de-aging. And so her body is collected and put in a coffin and sent to, if I remember correctly, a windmill. So inside the windmill, it needs to be guarded. And if I remember correctly, he gets the task of guarding the body. So to protect himself, he draws on the floor inside the windmill a circle. And during the night, the body comes alive, and the coffin rises up and starts to attack him, but it can't penetrate the circle, so it keeps banging the area of the circle over and over again, and eventually it stops and goes back down, and that's it. And it does this for at least two more nights, I think. But on the last night, she calls up all these creatures that come out of the woodwork and supposedly from hell, and the special effects are rather, you could say they're unintentionally funny. I mean, it's like the people who did the movie Meet the Feebles, if they made a horror film with the same production values. That's basically what it is.
Muppets, huh?
Well,
pack of Muppet
Mums. Kinda, but not quite. I wouldn't say they're Muppets. It's well, you'd have to see for yourself. It's wacky. It's, as I said, it's unintentionally funny. It's not scary. It's not scary at all.
Yeah,
I mean, I was expecting something, but no. So, I mean, that's basically all there is to the story. What rating would I give it? I would say 3.5 out of 5.
Cool.
You know, see it for if you want a good laugh. But, I mean, you can even show kids this if you want.
No.
But they might say, oh, this is boring.
Yeah, it sounded boring to me.
Well,
movie until the Muppets show up.
You can fast forward until when he starts guarding the body.
Oh, okay.
That's all I have.
Alrighty, well, I got two films. Yeah, this is one that I know you really want to go see, Mr. Highland. I know.
Oh.
It. Oh yeah. The Dead Don't Die. You know, the one with Bill Murray and Adam Driver and that favorite actress of yours. The blonde Swedish actress that you just absolutely love.
Yeah.
Every year she's like, you're like, oh my god. Yeah, Tilda Swinton. Oh god. Yeah, this is an interesting film. It's put as a comedy. It is kind of comedic in that it is written really weird. Very weird. I mean, it seems like the two main characters know that they're in a movie and they know that the world is weird in this. Supposedly, the way that the story goes is that this company experimented with some kind of new power source, and what it did is it knocked tilt off on the world and messed up the world's gravitational field and stuff slightly. And so daylight is longer than, you know, it should be. And one of the weird side effects is that the world is exposed to a weird type of radiation, and it's bringing the dead back to life in the evenings. So when the sun goes down, all of a sudden, zombies start coming up. And the centerpiece for this is a small town called Centerville. And this town only has a few buildings. It's got a mortuary. It's got a gas station, which is also the grocery and hobby shop, because it's all full of horror memorabilia. There's a hardware store. There is one restaurant and a motel. That's it. And there's people who live, farmers that live around there and stuff. When the film opens, Bill Murray and Driver are going to try to find a hermit, because a farmer that is played by God, what is his name? One that she would Steve Buscemi.
Buscemi,
yeah. He plays Farmer Frank Miller. And Bill Murray's character's name's Cliff Robertson. Cliff Robertson. And Adam Driver's character's name's Ronnie Peterson. But anyways, the hermit that they're looking for is named Hermit Bob, and he's played by Tom Waits. Supposedly, he has stole a chicken from Farmer Frank Miller. And so they're there to talk to him, and he's a gun freak. So, you know, the moment that they come into his area, he starts shooting at him, and they keep telling him, "No, stop. We just want to talk." You know, and he's like out there telling them to fuck off and stuff and that, and you know, he's a nice, friendly little hermit. Anyways, he's saying that, you know, he's telling him, you know, who cares about a damn chicken? Shit's happening. Things are weird around here. And, you know, and they're like, oh, okay, well, you know, just don't do it again, Bob. And they're walking away, and Adam Driver asks Bill Murray, you know, why aren't we arresting him? And he goes, oh, that's just Bob. You know, we always come out here and we never arrest him. So, you know, why would we now? So anyways, they go on the way back to town, and Driver turns on the radio, and there's this song playing called "The Dead Don't Die." And he goes, oh my God, I love this song. It's called "The Dead Don't Die." And he goes, why do I know that song? And Driver goes, because it's a theme song. Oh, okay. Well, anyway, so then it goes to the cafe, and the same music is playing. And you got Danny Glover, who's the guy who works at the hardware store. His name's Hank Thompson, and he's talking to Ushimi, you know, aka Frank Miller. And, you know, they're talking about all the shit that's happening, and he's going, yeah, well, how am I supposed to go to bed? You know, I mean, here it's 9 o'clock at night, and the sun's still high up in the sky. Bushimi's saying, well, why don't you have some more coffee? He goes, I don't want no more coffee. So anyways, you know, they decide to leave, and there's only the waitress and the boss there. They're the only ones there, these two ladies. And all of a sudden, two zombies come in. And, God, I can't remember. Some rock star is playing the guy zombie, and the girl zombie that's with him, who keeps her hand up behind her head, she's Adam Driver's wife, real life wife, and they go in and they attack the ones at the cafe and kill them and eat them. So anyways, you know, next day, Adam Driver and them and Bill Murray, they're coming to get coffee. They find Danny Glover there at the cafe, and he's the one that found the ones from the cafe dead. And the female member of their sheriff office, Officer Mindy Morrison, played by Chloe Sevigny, she's there and she's freaking out. So anyways, you know, they're investigating, and nighttime comes early this time, and all of a sudden zombies start coming out of the ground, you know, more zombies coming out of the ground, and soon the entire all the newer deaths have come up, and they're going through town, and, you know, they attack the motel and bite the guy who runs the motel, and he goes and he kills these tourists that are there. And so Adam Driver and them, they come around, find the bodies, and so he has a machete with him, and he chops off all their heads. And anyways, your favorite actress, Tilda Swinton, she's the lady that owns the mortuary, and she's a weird one. You know, she's into martial arts, and she's into sword fighting with the katana sword. So she's always wearing a katana sword with her, and she's got her little prayer area with the big giant Buddha, gold Buddha in there and stuff. And amazingly enough, she wears her gi and her sword while she's working on cadavers. And she's got these two people who have died, and she's fixing up their faces. And I swear she did the makeup job on them to where they look like your buddy Babette Bombshell. I mean, both the guy and the lady, she did the same makeup on them. So they both look like drag queens. And anyways, what ends up happening is they get up and she goes and chops their heads off. And so she sees that something's going on. So she's walking over to the sheriff's office, chopping off zombie heads as she's going. You know, just walking around with her sword, chop, chop, chop. And it's weird, you know, Tilda Swinton in this movie, she has kind of like an Irish brogue voice. You know, but they think that she's Scottish. But Scottish is, you know, Scottish is like this. And her is like, well, what you doing? What you doing, Sheriff? I don't know what's going on with this. Anyways, so just really freaky. So anyway, she decides to stay and monitor while he and Driver and them go running around town trying to find survivors and stuff. Danny Glover and the guy from the gas station, they're stuck in the you know, in the hardware place, and so they're locked up there and the zombies are going around. Anyways, one thing that they start finding out about these zombies is that these zombies have one-track minds. And it's like, you know, when they attack the gas station, they grab cell phones, and they were sitting there looking at the cell phones going, cell phone, cell phone. And these other ones had like iPads and stuff. iPad, iPad. And this other guy was dragging a guitar behind him. Guitar. Guitar. And so Bill Murray and them are going around and they're going, oh my God, it just seems like people have become so narrow-minded on themselves and on items that they've lost their souls, and that's why they're coming back. Anyway, so Adam Driver, at one point, he goes, I know that something's going to be going wrong. I know it because I've seen the script. And Bill Murray looks at him. He goes, you saw the entire script? I only saw the scenes with you and me in it. That's kind of that kind of shit. I heard that and I'm going, what the fuck? Anyways, yes, I know that. Spoilers. I'm bad. I'm a bad person for giving spoilers, but what the fuck? When I went to see this movie, it was an empty theater, so only my sister and I were there. So anyways, what will I give this movie? I give this movie a 4.5. I take one half of a spot off because it's just too weird. But if you like zombie films and you like really weird comedies, you'll love this one. And it's very well done. The camera work and everything is just fantastic. All right. So the next one, my next movie. Is that you, Georgie? You want a balloon, Georgie? I'm doing it. Chapter 2. I'll make it easy, Mr. Highland. Because for those of you who watched It, the miniseries, I can honestly tell you, you will be disappointed. Because this film, it has some great scares in it. It has the CGI at times that are a little bit weird, but it, you know, it works out. I really liked the actors playing their parts. They did fantastic jobs, but the writing on this particular installment of it was really clunky. But one thing I can say is that the ending was a lot better than the miniseries. So yes, you don't have to worry about a big ass CGI spider. Get something neat though. They do a kind of a nod to the spider, but the ending of the it creature, he is not actually in spider form. So yeah, I mean, you know, it's sad because this film had a lot of potential. The scares are really, really good on it. And some people would say, yeah, you know, well, what does it matter if story matters? Story matters. And, it, you know, when it comes to me, when I watch a movie, I want some story to it. I want a good story. I want a good logical story. They jump back and forth too much between the adults and the kids. They should have done like the miniseries and focused on the adults more than the kids, but they didn't. They kept going back to the kids, and it just made the story choppy as hell. The guy that played Pennywise, he did really good still in this. So I know Mr. Highland will be happy to hear that, because I mean, I know he just loves this Pennywise beyond measure, don't you, Mr. Highland?
No.
Yeah, anyways. Anyway, so let me see. What will I give it part chapter 2? 3.5, because you know what? I don't give a flying fuck, people, if a film is scary. And if it has good performances, it has to have a goddamn good plot and story. Because that's more important. It has to have a damn good plot and story. I mean, I can forgive some bad acting and that. But these people did, you know, they acted their hearts out in this film. And the story just, you know, the plotting of this just sucked. Alrighty, so that's it for it part 2, chapter 2. I did end up, when I went to the movie, I got an exclusive t-shirt, so I'm happy for that. See, Mr. Highland, that's when you miss out not going to the movie Cineplex. You're not getting your it exclusive t-shirt.
Yeah, well, I don't feel like sitting in a movie theater watching a 3-hour movie.
Yeah, I forgot. You know, yeah, you didn't know that the last time we tried to tape this that it was a 3-hour movie. And you were just like, what? You sound like Lil Jon. What?
Okay.
That was funny as hell. But anyways, alrighty. So anyways, Mr. Highland spent the entire month yet again. He really spends the month hard. He works hard for this show to get you music for the music break.
Yes.
And now it is time for that music break. So let's go and enjoy it. And then the real torture begins.
You're forgetting the fan mail.
No, that will be the one little bit of light in the agony that is to come. Alrighty, so enjoy the music break.
There I was completely wasting, out of work and down. All inside, it's so frustrating as I drink from town to town. Feel as though nobody cares if I live or die.
Introducing Warnenhaus.
Alert you when the hot water is out.
You are out of hot water.
Tell the Wi-Fi to hurry up. Keeps you in the know 24/7.
Boop. System check.
That doesn't sound right.
It's 2 a.m.
But Safe Auto can get you a great car insurance quote that could save you 25%.
Move over, humans. There's a new head of household.
Hello, my she-devils and demons. This is Nurse Hatchet, she-wolf of the wolf pack.
Alrighty, so that was our music break. Sorry, Mr. Hyatt. I got myself a drink, and thing is, something's weird's going on with my straw. Yeah, I get a lot of air in my straw, and I was coughing.
Oh, no, you're coughing this week. Last week, I was coughing.
Yeah, that's another thing that you guys missed out on, was Mr. Highland was coughing his little lungs out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, anyways. Alrighty. So, you sure you don't want a balloon, Georgie?
It sounds like you're auditioning for Father Brown.
Oh, God, no. Honey. So, yeah, it is time, you know, for us to recognize our fans with fan mail.
Mm-hmm.
And we got some weird-ass fan mail this month.
Oh, did we get any more from last week?
Nope.
Oh, man.
Oh, no, but we still got the weird shit that we got the last time. So anyways, here we go with our first piece of mail. And I'm still kind of suspicious about this. It's from Chris from Chicago.
Not me.
Hey, Full Spectrum. Love what you do. I got a couple of questions for you, if it's okay. First one is for Christopher Highland. Where do you find your info on upcoming books and comic releases?
Usually Amazon.com, also Valancourt, or Recorded Books. Usually there.
Okay. Okay, second is for William. Where do you find your info and the stuff you talk about? A lot of it seems to be underground or independent stuff. Actually, yeah, it is kind of independent and underground stuff. You know, I have a Tumblr account, and I'm always finding people talking about stuff on Tumblr and that. Also, there's this other website that I go to quite a bit that I really enjoy that has a lot of underground stuff on it. It's called The Broke Horror Fan. It's a really nice place, and you know, that's, you know, it's a nice place. I mean, you know, last week we had the guy who was talking about the Jason, well, Crystal Lake beer shirt and stuff. Yeah, that I found that on the Broke Horror Fan. They were also doing pins on it. And man, Mr. Island, you should get yourself, you know, one of those. It's a cool thing. You could wear it out to the bar.
I don't go to bars.
All right. How about the juice bar?
No. I don't do that either.
Starbucks.
No.
You don't get tea at Starbucks.
I don't like that company.
Okay, Phil's Coffee then. And don't tell me you like Pete's Coffee because, you know.
It's been a few months since I've drank coffee.
Okay. So, anyways, yeah. So, you know, I still recommend the damned, Crystal Lake beer shirt. It is cool. It is absolutely cool.
You'll have to show me a picture of it because I'm.
Oh yeah.
I haven't seen it.
Yeah, you'd love it. It's Jason Voorhees, and he's holding up a mug of beer. Funny as hell. Alrighty, so anyways, yeah, you know, and of course, you know, I also look around Amazon.com as well. But actually, Mr. Highland, your ghost stuff, I mean, I found the ghost retro theater or retro figure and the thing about the Funko Pop. I found those on Broke Horror Fan too, so you know now you know where I can find the stuff for your favorite band there, Ghost. Alrighty, so anyways, so that was the answers to that fan letter. Now my friend Rich Giordano would laugh his ass off on this. I don't know if this is the same guy, but Rich's nemesis is a guy called Richie from Boston. And this guy is a weirdo. He's a flat earther, and he believes that the government is spraying stuff in the sky to block the sun and stuff. Really weird guy. But anyways, yeah, so our next letter is from Richie from Boston. And actually, I'll do this in his voice. Hey, this is Richie from Boston. Keep up the good work. I love the old horror movies. And once in a while, you guys talk about movies I haven't seen. Then I'll go out and look for it. Also to William, I got that Jason Beard shirt you mentioned on the show. I wear it to the bar now, and people get a real kick out of it. Keep up the work, boys. Yeah, that's Richie from Boston. So see, I told you he liked the Crystal Lake Beard shirt. I totally forgot that he mentioned that in his letter. Cool. Alrighty, so here's one from Meg Craig from Rhode Island. Craig or Crag? I don't know. Cag. Oh, Cag. It's Cag. Meg Cag from Rhode Island. I want to thank you for letting me know about the Funko Edgar Allan Poe figure. I don't usually collect such things, but this one interests me. I'm a literary professor, and I thought it might look nice on my desk in my office. I hope they might do an H.P. Lovecraft Funko as well. Thanks for the information. Well, I don't know if they're going to actually do H.P. Lovecraft himself, but I do know that Funko does have a Cthulhu Funko. And yes, I know you say it's Cthulhu, but I say it's Cthulhu. But anyways, yeah, so, you know, they might have other literary ones for you too, Miss Keg. Tag. Keg. I don't know.
Interesting. That's anyway, pretty fast.
Yeah, I know. Anyway, so that's our mail for this month. If you want to send us mail, send it to the Eric Morris Show at gmail.com. I'll go through our mail and see if I can find some of the good ones, you know, because we get a lot of crap mail from crap people.
Oh, do we get any naked pictures or nude pictures?
No.
Damn.
Get your mind out of the sewer, Mr. Highland.
Too bad, already there.
Yeah, I don't think that anyone's going to be sending you Dom DeLuise pictures. Yeah, no. Don't do that, people. I get enough crap in my mail that I have to throw out. Oh, God. Okay, so with that note, oh boy. God. Now I get to go take a nice pill to get over my headache. Yeah, you keep laughing, boy. You know, as I said, you will know my name is the Lord when I bring my vengeance upon thee.
Yeah, well, it's a good thing we're not doing this show live in front of an audience.
Yeah. Yes, and in a studio where I could get my hands on you. You'd be sitting there going, yeah.
Yeah, you'd be the Homer Simpson, and I'd be the Bart Simpson.
I think I'd be Mo and you'd be Curly getting your head slapped.
Oh, I said you were Curly.
No. In this instance, you're Curly.
I thought I'd be Larry.
Okay, I'll rip your hair out. That's good enough. And poke you in the eye.
When you said Mo, I thought you meant Mo the bartender from The Simpsons.
No. Anyway, let's talk about this piece of crap. So have to suffer anymore. Oh my God, please spare me. Anyways, you know, one thing I can say, this film, at the beginning it shows Nazis and it talks about Nazis, and then the Nazis disappear after, what is it, the first 10 minutes of the damn film?
Yeah, pretty much.
Fuck, man, we needed the Nazis.
I know.
In this. We needed something, we needed the American soldiers coming in and start blowing the hell out of these jackasses.
Yeah, but one thing the listeners have to know is that the book, the movie compared to the book, is G-rated. And that might be hard to believe, but if anyone's read the book, they know exactly what I'm talking about.
Yeah, well, mention who the author of the book is.
Oh, well, it's Marquis de Sade.
Okay. And this movie takes place in World War II.
Two, yes.
During the occupation of, what is it, Italy?
Yes.
Yeah, occupation of Italy. Oh, God, save me. Yeah.
Yes. And there's something you have to know about the book.
Go ahead, it's your mic, Mr.
I know. Okay, as you know, it's rather explicit, but I'm gathering my thoughts here. Okay, only the first part of the book was written in its entirety. The second, third, and fourth sections are just notes. But the thing is, they're written in such detail, it doesn't take away from the book. But it's just as well that that's the case because it's repetitive.
Yeah.
There's no plot. Yeah, there's no plot. And, well, okay, I shouldn't say no plot. There's very little plot, I should say.
A drop.
Yeah. And the repetitiveness. And you put that together, which equals unintentional comedy. Very sly, sly intentional comedy. Knowing the nature of Marquis de Sade's character, I would definitely say it's intentional. And last week I mentioned that it was philosophical. He was commenting about people in power doing outrageous things. That's basically what this is.
Yeah, that's about right.
And now, remember I said before that last week that the book is G-rated compared to the movie. The book has tons of sex. Just sex and sex and sex, and just they're ingesting every known bodily
yes, understood.
Known, and it's just I keep describing it over and over and over again. And that's basically at least the first part. And it bleeds into the second part. It doesn't get truly gruesome until the last part, where they get into dismemberment. Now,
oh yes, they're going,
yeah. Now. The way he describes it, it's like making a salad, the chopping off everything like fingers, toes, hands, arms, heads, noses, eyeballs. I mean, just every body part you think of. And he keeps describing this just over and over and over again. And in the midst of all this, he stops and describes a young woman stuffed with gunpowder in every orifice. And she gets lit up and her bodies explode and her limbs go flying. And then he keeps describing the dismemberment. And I'm reading this and I'm thinking, hey, wait a minute, you can't do that. Go back, let's have more of this.
Yeah, I actually, you know, I mean, who was it?
I laughed out loud, reading that. I thought, no, more.
Yeah, I mean, the guy who did Reanimator, he did this movie for Full Moon Movie, and he had this one about this scene with this witch where she was downing gunpowder because they were gonna burn her, and she wanted to get revenge on him. And in the scene, I mean it was awesome, you know, for a low budget film. But she actually, they started her on fire and she blows up and her bones go flying in every direction and kills a whole bunch of people. It's great.
Is the effect intentionally comic or unintentionally comic?
I don't know if it was intentionally comic or not, but oh my God, it was.
But did you laugh?
Satisfying when you saw everything that they did to the people in that, because it's a movie about the auto da fe.
But did you laugh at the effect?
Not really, but you know how I am. I've been, you know, I've seen so much of this stuff that it doesn't really affect me.
It reminds me of this one movie that I saw where this little kid was playing with the door handle of a train and he pushes it and he flies out of the train, and I just laughed really hard and I thought, oh my God. If I saw that in the theater with a crowd of people, I probably would have been the only one laughing.
Yeah, I mean, I probably know that, and everyone would have been looking at you like, what?
Yeah, I mean, I know that they didn't intend that to be funny, but it just was.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Toots. Yeah. I don't know. Of course, you know, as they said, Marquis de Sade was a nutcase, anyways. You know, the idea of you know, blowing up women. I mean, shit.
I know. I mean, and given the nature of him, I mean, I can imagine this movie being remade by Rob Zombie. But it would probably have to be like, 6 hours.
Yeah, something like that. And
8 hours.
I would be bored to death, and Rob would get beaten to death crowds after doing it.
Or if it wasn't.
Yeah, you know who should do this would be Quentin Tarantino. Tarantino movie.
Yeah, it would be more explicit than anything you've done.
Yeah.
But the thing is, it would have to be done authentically, because the movie takes place during World War II, whereas the book takes place in the late 1700s.
Oh, no, he'd probably do the 1700s just for fun. You know, Rob Zombie, you know, you saw what he did with World War II. Now let's see him do you know, Victorian. Could you imagine a Quentin Tarantino Victorian film? Ooh. Starring Samuel L. Jackson as Marquis de Sade.
Yeah, that'd be funny. I'd watch that. You're forgetting what goes on in the movie.
Oh, no. I didn't
sure.
Think it was what goes on in the movie. How can I? It's burned in my fucking retina. I still can't get it out.
Yes.
Just remember, Mr. Highland, Demon baby house.
Oh, I thought I was a demon baby.
Oh, no, 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 no. We no, we are talking, you're going to be spending the night like Ghost and Mr. Chicken in the demon baby house.
Another movie I haven't seen yet.
In Chicago. You're going to have a ghost baby with horns chasing you around the halls. Isn't that going to be fun?
No.
Okay, so anyways, yeah, I know. I remember that this film had some in and outs.
Literally
ins and outs.
Yeah, but not as much as what was going on in the book. I mean, it was just tons and tons of sex. It was like,
Yes, and
it was like Grand Guignol, a bunch of people having sex on stage. I should say, piles of them. Strewn out along the floor.
You know, and of course, you know, I mean, you know, when you talk about a shit fest, this film is definitely a shit fest. Literally.
I know, they were eating it like chocolate ice cream.
I know. Yes, I know. Yeah, unfortunately, audience, yes, they did. They had a banquet where people were eating shit.
Did you look into the production to see what they were actually eating?
No.
Oh.
Thank God. That was enough to make me want to puke. Especially the one that they focused in on. Oh God, the one with the goo on it. That looked almost like strawberry syrup. Ugh, God damn. You see these ones with shit all over their faces. I mean, I know it had to be chocolate pudding or something that they smeared on them. And then they had that one scene that led into this shit fest. Where the guy's punishing the girl, and he goes and he pulls down his pants, squats down and shits on the floor, and orders the girl to eat the turd.
This is the kind of movie that I think Tom Six.
Yeah.
Watched in preparation for his Human Centipede movies.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. But anyways, yeah, the scene with that, they did some interesting little camera work so that the girl didn't have to eat the actual turd. Because they blurred the image for a few seconds. And all you see is you see her hand come up and you see her bring it to her mouth. You don't see her touch the turd on the floor. You don't see any of that. You remember that, Mr. Highland? It blurred enough that you didn't see that.
Yeah.
So the thing is that when they brought out these big serving trays, loaded, piled, huge ass fucking piles of that, and everyone, even the guards, are eating this shit. Oh, God. And do you know, Mr. Island, I just ate before doing this damn show.
So did I.
Yeah, but you don't care. With you, it's just, oh yeah, let's watch William squirm. Yeah, wait until midnight in the demon baby house. That's gonna be fun. Yeah, Mr. Highland's gonna be going in the demon baby house. He's gonna have a recorder with him to do EVPs and shit, and you know, gonna have to sleep there all night by himself. Demon baby house, the one where they see the demon baby looking out the window at people all the time, and people scream because they see a demon baby with horns. Woo, boy. Fun, huh?
In the book, I don't remember the banquet. All I remember, at least in the first part, is the amount of sex. I mean, it was as if the Marquis de Sade was describing himself and doing this. It was like he was...
What do you think he was doing?
It was like he was hosting a masterpiece theater, and you see the camera pan around all the people having sex, and you see a close-up of him. You see his face while he's having sex, and he says to the camera, "Hello, I'm Marquis de Sade, and welcome to Masterpiece Theater. Tonight we have a rather delicious story, rather dirty one."
You know, the one thing we haven't talked about, and was actually the only amusing part that I found in this entire movie.
Yeah.
Was all the blonde ladies with the big ass smiles on their faces who had to sit there and talk dirty stories.
Yeah.
Those ones were creepy as shit. With those smiles constantly on their faces while they were talking about all this. You know, and then dancing around and talking and dancing while they were telling these stories. And I remember the first time they did that, the guy told the woman that she had to be more detailed about it because he wasn't getting hard over it.
Yeah, it's like she's telling the story, and it's as if he were to say, "Dirty, dirtier, dirtier, come on, dirtier."
Yeah, pretty dirtier, much. Dad. And you know, honestly, you know what? They couldn't remake this film because they'd have a hard time finding the three ugliest misogynists around.
Oh, really?
Oh my fucking god!
There's
that mousy looking guy. That guy was scary as shit.
They could find actors who could do it. Even if
Actually, they could find one because there was this one. Remember in Harry Potter, the Hallows, the first. Yeah, it was the first part. They had that guy that Ron Weasley had to make himself look like with the mustache.
No.
Guy looks exactly like, you know, one of those guys actually looks exactly like that.
Hmm.
And actually, you know what? The one that Harry Potter had to become, if they put a beard on him, he might have been the president. So the guy that Harry Potter did was Mr. Shit Boy. Shit fetish. Isn't that nice?
Oh, I'm remembering other stuff that was in the last part of the book. Let's see, what happened? Oh, yeah, the one of them stuck a red hot poker up some of a girl's and another one had their front sewn up.
Yeah, I remember.
So they couldn't relieve themselves. And another one had a rat put up their butt. And I think that was that might have been sewn up as well. But regardless of that, it ate its way out.
Yeah, no doubt. That was one of the regular tortures that they had at the auto da Ve.
Oh.
Except the thing is that they wouldn't put it up the backside. What they'd do is they'd put a cut in the chest, and they'd put the rat underneath a bowl, and the rat would start digging in and go after the person's heart.
Wow.
Because of the thumping.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, that was one of the tortures in the auto da Ve. Of course, they also used to put put people's head in cages and have the rats try to eat their eyes out.
That I know about.
Yeah, that one's an easy one. Eat their eyes and nose. But anyways, yeah, so... But, you know, I mean, the thing is, there was one part in the movie where they actually had some real action and some real excitement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was when they started, when the ones started confessing. You know, when it started with the girl that the guy, that the the sadist found. You know, the one girl told the other. Told on the other one about the fact that she had a picture of her father under her pillow and stuff. So he went and he grabbed that, and she told on this other person. And then the other person told on the other person, and the other one told about the affair that the one guard was having with one of the maids. And they find him and the maid in bed together, and they end up blasting away the guard, shooting him about, what was it, 10 times in the chest.
Yeah.
And they shoot her. You know, she was a black maid. Yeah, that was the only really interesting part of that damn thing, was just that one set of scenes. The rest of it was just complete and utter dog shit. Well, actually, I should say human shit, because that's what it was, human shit. Yeah. So,
commenting on what you said before about finding actors for a possible remake, I mean, it doesn't have to be a full-fledged... accurate adaptation of the novel. I mean, it could be something that's inspired by it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, just with focusing more on the dark humor.
Okay, we already got that. It's called The Serbian Film.
Really? That had dark humor in it?
Oh, yeah.
Really? Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you haven't watched Serbian film, obviously.
Yeah, but is it, slapsticky?
No.
Damn.
Let's just put it this way. I watched that film and I felt dirty after watching it. I had to take a bath and scrub myself afterwards. It was that disgusting.
And thanks for the visual.
No. No, it is scary. That was that movie was just absolutely horrible. You know, steel wool. Oh God. You and Day Green, you know, revenge needs to be coming pretty damn soon. I mean, first, you know, she hits me with slaughtered vomit dolls, which I lasted 20 minutes on, mind you. Then you get me with this piece of crap.
Yeah, but you actually watched the end of it. What do you think's worse, this or...
Yeah, well, I had to because I'm the producer of this damn show and I'm stuck having to watch it.
What do you think's worse, this or what she meant, recommended?
This was worse, but still, I'm not a person who gets my hots out of watching a person vomit on another person. And then of course, you know, I found the footage from the sequel, which had the Saskas in it. And remember I told you that there's this one spot in that one scene with the Saskas where they're puking on that dying girl and stuff, and all of a sudden this guy comes up with that looks like Derek with the beard and the glasses and the baseball cap, and he starts puking on the Saskas. Yeah, I told Derek, and he goes, "Well, that wasn't me." I said, "I didn't think it was you there, Derek, but I couldn't believe it. This guy looks exactly like you, and he was puking on the Saskas." God.
So what happens in the last part of the movie?
What do you mean?
Remember, they start...
They start torturing the ones that they had on lists.
Yeah.
Done things not acceptably. Or who broke the rules.
Yeah, they start... one of the things they do is they cut out one of their tongues.
Yeah, they did that.
And I'm watching it, and I thought, yeah, that's fake.
Yeah, branding irons, yeah. Flames, all kinds of different shit.
Yeah, just when they start getting to the really gruesome stuff, they end the movie.
Yeah, well, they still ended it very grossly anyways, because the exact ending of the movie, you know, here I was waiting for the Americans to come and save the day and, you know, and blow these fuckers up. Instead, two guards are sitting there. They start dancing and talking about their girlfriends. And that's how the film ends. Is these two guys waltzing together and talking about their girlfriends. Ugh, God damn. Yeah, that movie just... don't ever do that to me again. Oh, God. I've got...
As I said before, someone could...
I got a headache again.
As I said before, someone could make a something that's inspired by the dark humor. I can imagine someone having a scene where they do a parody of the banquet scene, but instead of shit, they have a bunch of bloody body parts. And
already been done.
No, but the way I'm describing it, they start to eat, but in the midst of all this, one person throws, let's say, an eyeball up across the table at someone, and then someone throws a finger and it bounces off someone's nose, and then and this just just spirals into body part and organ throwing. Like, you see a bloody heart and a hand, an arm, even a penis.
There was an Asian film that they did exactly that.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Send me the title, but
I can't remember the title, and I
but it's just a storm of
that too.
But it would be just a storm of body parts and blood just flying all over the place at each other, and then in the midst of all this, someone is either pounding on the door or you hear a doorbell and they stop and they all rush to the door and they greet whoever's at the door, and they're all covered in blood and body parts and stuff that's hanging off there, and as if it's the most natural thing in the world. Say, hey, how you doing?
Lovely, Mr. Highland. Why don't you just write that up and send it to some filmmaker to do?
Yeah, the right one. The right one who would
You just have to find out who did August Underground, and they'll do it for you.
Hmm. Yeah, the right kind of dark humor.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Nick, moisture in your chocolate ice cream?
No.
No?
God damn. I have got a migraine now. Thinking about this just like last week.
Yeah, I can imagine if this was turned into a TV show like it was Monty Python for the introduction. Someone could be, maybe you could have an opera singer and it would pull back. It would show them as they're trying to hit the high notes and the low notes, they're getting you could show them getting a blowjob.
Yee. God, you just want to torture me some more, don't you, Mr. we're gonna have you chained to the couch too. Demon baby house. Big old chain around your neck. Put a cat box over in the corner for you. They're all night.
Hey, you think that the literary professor we had give the fan mail is going to have her students read the book?
Oh, God. Damn. Mr. Highland, you just lost us a fan. Happy? Oh my God, that was... Okay, calm down, Mr. Highland. Remember your asthma. Oh, God. Okay, anything more that you want to talk about this shit fest, or are we done? I gather that's a yes, we're done.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Anything you want to say to our victims? I mean, fans.
Yes. Thank you for listening, and tune in next time, where we are going to have something awfully extra special. Something that is, I have been planning for about a year, and just might be our best show ever.
Yeah, and the thing is, it doesn't have anything to do with torture, and it doesn't have anything to do with body elements or that. it's going to be movie talk, but nothing of a sexual nature. So you're okay, Beavis. Oh my god, damn. So anyways, yeah, so this is William Pattison, King of Splatterpunk, and over there is Christopher Highland, King of poopy porn. Keep America strong. Watch horror films. And God save us. Oh my God.
The love that you bring, bring me along. The pain that you give, gives me a home. Do you wanna stay by my side? Do you want me to turn it on? Disappearing inside, seeing pictures of our goodbyes. We believe that our love will survive the pain that you bring. Brings me all alone. Do you love me? Think that you don't need me? Do you wanna deceive me? I can't. when we broke the mold. The dreams when you see that goodbye's so long.
The internet.